The Human Development Institute hosts the State of HDI podcast. The views and opinions expressed in this program are those of the speakers and may not reflect the views of the University of Kentucky. A downloadable transcript is available in the description. Thank you for listening.
Welcome to the State of HDI, a University of Kentucky Human Development Institute podcast. With me in the studio is Katie Wolf-Whaley, Principal Investigator of the Supported Employment Training Project, President of Kentucky APSE, former board member of the National APSE, and Chair of the Kentucky Employment First Council. Katie, welcome.
Thanks. It's good to be here.
So your credentials are amazing. And you have so many connections to the employment of people with disabilities. Tell me what Employment First means to you.
So Employment First means that employment is the first and primary option for people with disabilities of working age who want to go to work. That when we are looking at publicly funded services for people, we look at employment before we look at other ways to spend one's day. Just like most people, most adults in our society do.
Makes so much sense. So where did Employment First start?
It started as a philosophy. Historically, employment rates for people with disabilities have been staggeringly low. For decades and decades, the unemployment rate for people with disabilities has been right around double that of people without disabilities. And a lot of that was because just as a society, people didn't understand the capabilities and gifts and skills and talents that people with disabilities have, and that they could work in typical businesses with everybody else and be successful. And so the system created other ways for people to spend their day where they would be safe and protected and have somewhere to go and perhaps something to do. And over time, people realized folks have so much more to offer than we had thought. And people were getting jobs, getting good jobs. There were plenty of examples of folks, even with significant disabilities, getting good jobs. But the system wasn't set up to, one, presume that people could work and that's what they'd want to do. And even if they did want a job, the system wasn't set up to have that be that first and primary option. And so it began as a philosophy of, oh my gosh, people can do so much more than we think, and we are kind of suppressing people's potential and their income potential in this way. And then people started fighting for the right to be able to go to work, to be included in the community. And there's lots of history of, as this podcast has talked about, history of disability rights in our society. And employment became a part of that. And so this idea of employment first, that we had to make it really clear that employment be the first and primary option. Because when we aren't crystal clear about that, it's always back down as, oh yeah, maybe we'll help you get to that when you're ready or when we get around to it or can find someone that can help you. And so that's where Employment First came from. And then it started to become policy and regulation and executive order and law to make that priority clear that this has to be the way things are done. There are now over 40 states that have a formal executive order or legislation that employment be that first and primary option for people who desire to become employed.
I love that. And just the idea that, yes, it should be the expectation. All right. So you said 40 states have Employment First as their official rule, and that includes Kentucky.
It does include Kentucky. So we got an executive order that was signed by former Governor Bevin in May of 2018. The executive order was renewed and signed again in 2020 by Governor Beshear. And then in March of 2022, it was passed as state law in Kentucky with that priority statement for employment being the first and primary option. Both the executive order and then the law also had the Employment First Council, which is charged to make sure that happens, because it takes a lot of change and it's a big shift.
So how does HDI fit into this?
That's a great question. So HDI has had employment as one of its priorities. And when the executive order was first signed, the council was established, and HDI is one of the required entities to have a representative on the council. And then for those first 4 years, while the council was under executive order, HDI also served as the administrator of the council.
That's great. And then can you share some of the successes that you've seen since?
Sometimes it's hard to point to tangible successes. I think getting the word out and really trying to be intentional around raising those expectations has been a big thing that has happened. And it's brought all of these different entities on the council together, again, to have to talk about employment, that that's the priority. I spend a lot of my time, all of my time, thinking about disability and employment because those are all the issues that surround my work here at HDI. And I have been honored to be the HDI representative on the council. A lot of the people on the council, employment is part of what they do or what their agency does as their representation. So this brings all of those different policymakers, decision makers, leaders, representative of different interest groups, and including people with disabilities and family members, together to have to focus on employment and what's it going to take for things to get better. Who do we need to talk to? Who do we need to reach out to? And really look at what are the policies in these different state agencies and public education, and where do families get their information, and how can we really address policies and disincentives that exist out there, because there are, they keep people from working, and then how do we get good information into the hands of folks with disabilities and their family members and their own support systems to realize this is a much more viable option than maybe we thought it was.
Okay, and can you tell me a little bit about Project Neon? I know when we were talking before the podcast, that was one that you really felt was had been successful.
Yeah, so Project Neon stands for something, and it's an ODEP initiative, which is the Office of Disability Employment Policy, which is part of the Federal Department of Labor. And Neon has existed in different forms to provide states technical assistance around increasing competitive integrated employment. And this last year, Kentucky applied to be a Project Neon state and was accepted. And it has partnered with the Employment First Council very closely and the Public Policy Committee of the Employment First Council to take specific policies and regulations in different state agencies to say, this is what Employment First means, that employment is that first and primary option. What do the regulations for example, some of the HCB Medicaid waivers, some of the education policies, how is your policy written? How is it funded? What are the priorities in there? And how does that align with Employment First? Or where are there gaps? And being really intentional and having a rubric and going through those policies together to see where it doesn't align, really, in a lot of cases. And then what can be done about that? It's one thing to say, oh, we need policy and regulation change and we need to shift our funding systems. That is an enormous task. The NEON process has really helped us target in on at least starting with a handful of few key policies to see, okay, here's the specifics of where it mentions it and where it doesn't, so that we can make recommendations, clear and specific recommendations for change of this language or the way this is done or the way the agencies collaborate. It's too easy to get lost, right? To go from VR to the IDD system. It makes sense when I talk about how the system should work. It doesn't always make sense to real people who are living in the system. And so those are the kind of things that we're trying to identify so that if we can make clear recommendations, I think we're more likely to see potential for change, because changing systems is hard.
Well, Katie, I really appreciate you taking time to sit down with us. Do you have anything that you'd like to say in closing?
I think one of the other key pieces of Employment First is, I mean, where HDI is, of course, it's looking at people with disabilities and the opportunities they have and the systems that support them. But it's very much a two-sided issue, because if we don't talk about workforce development, we're absolutely missing the point. It's one thing to support someone well and figure out what they have to offer and how to help them find a job. But we have to talk about workforce development and to make sure that when we talk about the labor crisis in our state, people with disabilities are seen as a key staffing strategy. And that when workforce development is being talked about, people with disabilities are a part of that conversation, not, oh yeah, well, there's this other part B of the paragraph where we're supposed to include this group, but really an integral conversation. Because if employers don't get it and don't see that what people have to offer and understand what resources and supports are out there for people to be successful employees, they're less likely to get jobs. And so we have to be talking both sides of the issue at the same time.
Well, Katie, thank you so much.
Thank you.